What's up, Harvest? My name is Ben France. I get to serve as the student pastor out at our Crystal Lake campus. And I'm just so excited that you've chosen to join us today, our Harvest Bible Chapel online service. And you know what? Earlier, I was thinking, it's crazy. It feels just like yesterday when it was 2016 and I was loading all my stuff up into a truck to come out here and join the Harvest family. But, you know, it's 2020 now, believe it or not. Over halfway through 2020, as a matter of fact. And so much has stayed the same and so much has changed. We still love our Crystal Lake family. I still love serving and Harvest students, and that has stayed the same, and the Lord has stayed the same, and that's incredible. But man, in those 4 years, my life's changed incredibly. My wife Lauren and I, we got married, and we have a wonderful son, Peter James, who's about 19 months now, and then we actually have a little girl on the way due in November, and we are just so excited for that. Thanks for just being there in excitement with us. And like I said, I have the privilege of serving as a student pastor at Crystal Lake. And man, Harvest students over the last few months has been strictly online, but we're working really, really hard to get back in person. We've got some things in the works we're excited to tell you about here in the next few coming weeks. But in the meantime, we are meeting online. Our next online gathering is September 30th. That's this coming Wednesday at 7 p.m. So if you're in 6th through 12th grade or know someone in 6th to 12th grade, we'd love for you to join us. You can get more information on our social media accounts, especially Instagram at We Are Harvest Students, or of course, harvestnow.info. And of course, if you've been around the church for a while, you know that maybe you've heard this, that we aren't a church with small groups. We're a church of small groups. See, small groups is the heartbeat. It's the backbone of the ministry we do here. And if you're in a small group, you know what that feels like to have that community. You know, small groups are for building community, for having accountability, for growing in our walks with Christ. And if you're in that, you know that, but maybe you're not. And I just want to encourage you to join. Maybe this is the day that you decide you're going to reach out and do something new and join a small group. If that's you, if you want more information, you can go to harvestnow.info and you get all the information about small groups, or you can reach out to your local campus pastor and they would love to get you connected. Well, Harvest, you've got an awesome service. So maybe you're still laying in bed, or maybe you're in your living room with your family. Wherever you are, I just want to encourage you right now to join us as we continue in worship in spirit and in truth.
I was rejected and cut off from hope. I couldn't see His love for me.
That's right.
He said He's not who He seems. Don't get your hopes up for Him, but lies fell away when I saw His face.
My heart burns to life.
Now I know whose I am, ever I'll stand on.
Hey Harvest. If you're just joining us again, my name is Ben France. I get to serve as the student pastor over at our Crystal Lake campus, and I just want to welcome you to Harvest Bible Chapel online. We're so glad that you've joined us, and especially if this is your very first time. If you're a first-time guest, I just want to personally say welcome. We're so glad that you've tuned in, and we would love to know that you're here. We would also love to know where you're watching from, so maybe if you're comfortable with it, throw it in the comment section, throw it in the chat. We'd love to just connect with you that way. Welcome. Thanks for jumping on and tuning in to worship with us today. And regardless if this is your first time or if you've been here tons and tons of times, I want to encourage both of those different groups of people to check in. Checking in isn't just something so we know, have a number for attendance. You know, we want to know that you're here. We want to know how we can care for you and how we can be praying for you throughout the week. And you can do that two ways. One is through the Harvest Bible Chapel app. And the second, there's a link in the chat for you to do that. So right now, grab your phone, grab your computer, whatever, and check in for us. We'd love to connect with you that way as well. And I can't believe I'm the one that gets to do this, but I get to officially announce that as of today, we now offer, again, an in-person option for a worship service across all of our six campuses. That's right. We're launching, we're back. It's so, so awesome, and praise God for that. And you know what? Maybe you're sitting there thinking, that's awesome, praise God, but I'm not quite ready for that. Well, that's okay. We still have an online option every Sunday at 9 and 11 a.m., and if maybe you can't make it to either of those things, that's okay, because on our Harvest website and our Harvest YouTube page, you can watch the service for this week on demand anytime you want during the week. You know, see, we understand that it's been a crazy season, but you know what? We couldn't have done any of this, especially these online services, if it wasn't for your faithful giving. Thank you, everyone who has given and worshiped the Lord in that way. And we have four options for you to give. The first one, of course, is online at harvestbiblechapel.org. The second is you can send a text. We have all the information right there in front of you. You can shoot a text right now. And of course, you can give on the mobile app. And then lastly, if you're still into snail mail, you can always give your gifts by mailing it to the Rolling Meadows campus. Thank you for doing that. You can do it now. You can do it throughout any day during the week. Thank you for worshiping the Lord and continuing to give. And then lastly, as many of you know, Pastor Dave Stone has been here filling our pulpit and serving the Lord in our church by preaching to us for 18 months. But this weekend is his last weekend. So we want to take an opportunity to thank him and his wife, Beth, for just the sacrifice that they've done, for sticking it out with us and for preaching the word so faithfully to us. You know, to celebrate this occasion, I'm going to send it back to the worship center to the chairman of our elder board, Brian Laird.
Hello, Harvest family. 1 Timothy 5:17 says, "Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching." So today, the elders, along with all of you, we wish to give double honor to someone who's been doing that very thing with us for well over a year. Back in the first months of 2019, our church began to enter into the greatest crisis of its history. In a matter of just a few short weeks, our whole world turned upside down. Most of our senior leaders had left. Our elder board was in the process of a full transition, and our staff and church family were uncertain of the future. But in the Lord's providence, Dave and Beth Stone showed up and began to minister to our very hurting church. While we are all blessed to have Dave labor in preaching God's word and teaching us, many of you may not know the work that Dave has done behind the scenes. As soon as Dave came to Harvest, he began to meet with the staff, began shepherding and helping us. He jumped in to counsel many of us who were struggling with confusion and uncertainty. Dave took time out of his schedule to be present not only to preach on the weekends, but to also be present during the week. He and Beth would often arrive midweek in order to spend time with others. There are countless stories where God used Dave to speak into meetings in unique, powerful, and lasting ways. And Beth, as well as supporting Dave's time away from home to be present with us, would often spend time with others here and serve in Harvest Kids on the weekends. Dave had recently transitioned from his position as senior pastor of Southeast Christian and wasn't planning on jumping into another church to help them in their time of need. In fact, to hear them tell the tale, they're supposed to be kicking back for a bit. But they didn't do that. They have constantly sacrificed their time and energy in order to bless and truly help our Harvest family. Dave and Beth, we thank you. We thank you for putting the kingdom of God first. Thank you for believing and walking in the truth that it is better to give than to receive. Thank you for connecting with people one at a time, learning their names, and teaching us that each person does matter. Thank you for your example to us of serving the Lord together. Thank you for walking in humility before all who know you, for thinking of others more than yourselves. Thank you for holding up the authority of God's word in our pulpit. Thank you for committing your lives to love God and to love others. Thank you for fully immersing yourselves and embracing our church, a family as your own. Sorry, this is a little harder than I thought it was going to be. Thank you for embracing our church as your family. When the Lord knew we desperately needed care and guidance, words fail to adequately thank you. And we want to honor you today with gratitude and trusting that the greatest reward awaits you in eternity with Jesus. 2 Corinthians 9:12 tells us, "For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God." We want you to know that God has greatly blessed and ministered to us through both of you. Thank you for being so faithful. We want to present you with these gifts on behalf of our entire church as a small token of our gratitude to you. And we pray that God will continue to be blessed through you and in you wherever you may go. Carl, will you pray for us?
Sure. God, we come to you with grateful hearts, grateful for the season of time that we've had Dave and Beth to minister among us, thankful for the ministry that they have served us with, thankful for your ministry to us, using them as your tools. God, thank you for drawing them close to yourself in a way that makes them transparent, and it is so easy to see your love through their actions. We are a better church and are forever changed for it, and we are grateful. God, I ask that as they move forward into this next season of life, I ask that you would just give them a special hand of protection, that you would watch over them, that you would draw them close to you in a way that you haven't yet, and that you would draw them close to each other. God, once again, we thank you. And we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue with our worship.
God hasn't hidden himself. There are evidences all around us that point to the reality that God is who he says he will be. Account after account, all throughout Scripture, God the Father proves himself to be the sovereign God over all of his creation. Jesus proves himself to be the Son of God, the Christ, the life giver, the miracle worker. And the Spirit proves himself to be the very presence of God with us in our world today. And sometimes it's easy to see the evidence of the presence of God, the evidence of his work, whether it's an answered prayer or a miraculous provision met. But sometimes it's difficult to see where or how God is working, especially when that situation just hasn't changed, when we're still waiting, when we're still praying. Church, but God's word makes promises that shine light into the places that we just can't see. When the path forward seems dark and uncertain, we need to remember, I need to remember that his word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. When it seems like the situation just won't change, I need to remember that God promised to finish the good work that he has begun to completion. And when it looks like the story is over, when it looks like or seems like the bad is screaming louder than the good, I will look past what I see with my physical eyes to believe the reality that God takes what the enemy meant for evil and uses it for the good of his people, for his glory. The Lord is working it out. He is moving in the unseen. So God, we pray, would you give us the eyes to see? Would you give us the faith to believe as we sing this truth? As we sing this truth to you now, that you're working, that you're working.
Hi. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop.
You're working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop.
Come here today to say that you are the creator and we are the creation. You are the creator of the universe. You spoke the universe into existence. Couldn't help but thank the Lord, as Tara was speaking earlier, just how you are always there. Even when we don't see you working, we know that you're at work. We trust your plan. We trust your timing. Remind us that your delays are not denials, and that you are still working and unfolding your will according to your plan. We thank you that you're never late and that you're never early and that you're always on time. And we thank you that you reign. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I want to say thank you for some of those kind, loving and encouraging comments that were made a little bit earlier. I don't know how deserving I am of those, and I just say that at the end of my message, I'll try to share some more personal thoughts about my time here, but I'm so grateful to each one of you. Several years ago, I learned that most all instructions and directions are written at a fifth grade level. In other words, they are just so basic and elementary. I didn't believe that until I actually started checking out instructions and reading them just to see. And they are sometimes downright hilarious in the way that they are written, because they are written so in such obvious fashion. For instance, if you have a Rowenta iron, it comes with a warning beside it on a little piece of paper. It says, "Do not iron clothes on body while wearing them." Okay? I don't know if that's really necessary. Let me just say that if you are trying to save time by ironing your clothes while you are wearing them, you probably need to build a little bit more margin into your schedule, all right? Several years ago, I was walking through a mall in Kentucky, and there was a little store there where a person could get their ears pierced. I didn't think a whole lot of it until I took a look at the sign, and you know what the sign said? It said, "Ears pierced while you wait." And I thought, well, how else are you going to get your ears pierced, you know? It's not going to be, "I'll be back in an hour. Will they be ready? What? What?" No, it's not going to happen, right? It's the only way you, yeah, thank you for the three of you that got that, okay? My favorite was a number of years ago at Father's Day, my mom gave me a gift, and it was something called auto shades. And you all are probably familiar with auto shades. It's something that you put on the inside of your car windshield in the midst of the heat of summer, so that when everybody else's car is sweltering when they get in, not you. You know, yours is only 96 degrees instead of 98 degrees, right? That's the difference that it makes. But my mom gave me this, and she said, "Oh, I think you'll really like them." And then when she gave them to me, she said, "Make certain that you read the instructions." I'm like, it can't be that tough, right? Okay? But I want to share with you the actual instructions that accompanied my auto shades. Number one, unfold auto shades inside of the car. Good. Number two, push the cutout portion behind the rearview mirror. Helpful. Number three, pull the sun visors down to hold the auto shades in place. That was good. I had not thought of that one. But number four, warning, do not drive car with auto shades in place. I mean, is that really necessary? Had that become an issue? Evidently, it had, right? Well, today, as I conclude my interim ministry here at Harvest, I thought I would just try to preach a sermon that was very basic and, like instructions, was just kind of written at a fifth grade level. And it would just be so obvious and clearly stated what it is that Christ expects of us that we could just kind of renew our focus. Years ago, C.S. Lewis said it like this. He said, "Sometimes rather than hearing new ideas, we need to be reminded of old truths." And so today we're going to look at some old truths that Jesus laid out to his disciples right after the Last Supper and just before his arrest and his subsequent crucifixion. If you'll take your Bibles out, I want to encourage you to turn to the Gospel of John. And we're going to take a look at John chapter 15. Now, there are four chapters right along here that appear in John's gospel that we didn't have when we walked through the material didn't appear in our walkthrough of the Gospel of Mark in our Just Jesus series. And if you'll turn to John 15, you will discover that Jesus is giving his last discourse to the disciples prior to his crucifixion. And this is actually his last time. It's the lengthiest teaching that we get from Jesus. He's going to focus on what is the most elementary and basic. He's going to boil everything down to that fifth grade level of what's most important. And so I figured if it was advice that was good enough for the early followers of Christ, that it would probably be appropriate for each of us today as followers of Christ. If you look in your Bible, we'll begin with John chapter 15, verse 1. Jesus says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser." Skip down to the fourth verse. "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine,
Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. You must abide in Jesus. And at first glance, that might sound like a nebulous term or a confusing phrase. Jesus says, abide in me. And yet it is the most basic and elementary principle which over time will yield the most fruit. The word abide means to stay or to remain or to dwell or to live. Or I like this, to establish a permanent residence. In other words, you're letting Jesus just take up a place in your heart, in your life, and he's there forever. He is the life-giving vine, and we are the branches. And a branch that becomes disconnected is nothing but a stick. But if a vine is connected, it is alive and it is vibrant. And all throughout John chapter 15, it's all about the difference that's made when we stay connected to the vine, when we stay connected to the source, Jesus Christ. He enables us to do what we cannot do on our own. And when I stop depending on the true vine, Jesus Christ, and when you take a detour from the divine, it always leads to dishonoring and disappointing him. Sometimes it's my selfishness. Other times it's my recklessness. But it always comes back to my pride. That's at the heart of every sin that I commit. In my heart, I don't think I need a vine. I am capable of doing things myself. But Jesus speaks truth when he says, apart from me, you can do nothing. And that's why he continues to tell us to abide in him, to remain in him. And in John chapter 15, in the opening 11 verses, 10 different times, Jesus says the word remain, or he says abide, depending upon which translation you're using. And he says that over and over again. Why would he do it? Well, he's trying to put it down to a fifth grade level. He's trying to make certain that we can understand it. He's putting it down on a lower shelf where we can actually reach it. And repetition is used by a teacher in order to make certain that they drive home a point, to make certain that you get it. And the disciples are going to need that reminder to remain, that reminder to abide, because things are going to get pretty chaotic in the next few hours. And so he wants to make certain that they stay connected to him. By faithfully living in Christ and abiding in him, there are two positive, significant attributes which will flow out of your lives if you abide in Christ. Here's the first one. If you are abiding in Christ, then love should naturally flow from you. It should just be natural and normal. That's what should happen. Love should just flow out of you. Take a look at your Bible at verses 9 and the beginning of 10. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. And Jesus says, I have loved you the very same way that God loved me. In other words, Jesus is not asking his followers to do something that he's not willing to do himself. And notice that Jesus doesn't say that everyone that you love is going to love you back. He doesn't say that. That's what makes love so difficult for us. That's why back in John 13, in the midst of this same conversation that Jesus is having with his disciples, he says, love will be the distinctive. This is how everyone will know that you're one of my followers, by your love one for another. I guess it was last week I came across a verse that just kind of jumped off the pages at me. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1. Let love be your highest goal. I'm sure I've read it countless times, but for some reason in this season it just jumped off the pages at me. Paul is saying you be intentional. You work harder at love than anything else. You look for opportunities to love people and then you follow through. And Jesus keeps emphasizing this word, abide, and sometimes we think it's all about doing or it's all about earning our way to heaven, but really it's all about abiding in Christ, having a life that has set up a permanent residence with him. And then the connection with Christ leads to production. When we connect to Jesus, we will follow him, and Jesus will flow through our lives. Following leads to flowing, and his love for others flows through us. And here in John chapter 15, we learned that if we remain attached to the vine, to Jesus, abiding in him, then his love will just naturally flow through us. You probably are aware that the early Christians were known by their love. And let me back that claim up for you. There was a second century historian by the name of Aristides. He was commissioned by the Roman emperor at that time to help acquaint him, the emperor, with who the Christian community was. And so he had Aristides do this thorough study and all this research on the Christians so that he could just kind of find out really who they were and what they were like. And this is what Aristides wrote to the emperor back in 137 AD. They show love to their neighbors. They do not do to another what they would not have done to themselves. They speak gently to those who oppress them, and in this way they make them their friends. It has become their passion to do good to their enemies. Listen to this. They live in the awareness of their smallness. And every one of them who has anything gives ungrudgingly to the one who has nothing. And if they see a traveling stranger, they bring him under their roof, and they rejoice over him as over a real brother, because they know they are brothers in God. And if anyone among them is poor or comes into want while they themselves have nothing to spare, then they fast for 2 or 3 days for the other person. And in this way, they can supply any poor man with the food that he needs. This, O emperor, is the rule of life of the Christians. And this is their manner of life. I want you to think about that for just a minute. These Christians didn't even have a compilation yet of the complete New Testament at this time. All they had to go on what had been passed on for decades, and that was that Jesus, the one who came back from the dead, the one who said, "A new commandment I give you, love others as I have loved you." That's what they had to go on. And love stands in sharp contrast to what we have been witnessing and seeing during these last several months in our country, during this time of worldwide pandemic and social unrest. And we all have our opinions, and we're all convinced that we could lead through these situations much better than our boss or our governor, much better than our police chief or our president. Our pride can be astounding at times. But one thing we can all agree on, and that is that in these past 6 months, we have seen increased isolation leading to emotional anxiety, coupled with a time of rising racial tension, and then completing the perfect storm is this period of political polarization, which is culminating in a presidential election in less than 40 days. And yet, the brutal truth is, out of all of those challenges that I just listed, a vaccine won't fix any of them. It will take something more potent and powerful than a prescription or a pill. It will take something that provides more inspiration than an injection can give, something more soothing than a serum. And Jesus is saying exactly what it will take. It will take love, undeserved, uncomfortable, unconditional, unending love, a love that is only possible when you abide in Jesus Christ. And there's a verse in Matthew chapter 24, verse 12. It simply says, "Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold." In other words, Jesus is saying, when Satan intimidates and evil escalates and a culture deteriorates, there's a temptation to want to pull back. And if you lose that connection with Christ, and if you stop abiding in him, then you may not love or serve someone who looks different than you, or who votes different than you, or who acts different than you. And as a result, they may not receive your love. You know why? Because your love has grown cold. And Jesus Christ says, if you ever find yourself, living in such a season or time like that, you will be tempted to hold back. But he's saying, I want you to dive in. I want you to love each other just as I have loved you. And the very next day after he says that, while hanging on a cross, he will pray, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And rather than revenge, he prays for mercy. Instead of condemnation, he prays for restoration. We don't have emperors anymore. But what if today, in 2020, what if someone was commissioned in your neighborhood to acquaint some political leader with who Christians are? If they observed your life, would love even be mentioned in the report? Look back at our text, John chapter 15, verses 10 and 11. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. I love that phrase, that your joy may be full. And that leads us to the other positive and significant attribute that comes from remaining in Jesus. The first is that of love. The second is that of joy. We write it out this way. If you are abiding in Christ, then joy should be evident in your life. Joy should be evident. Happiness is based on happenings. It's dictated by circumstances. On Friday, the Harvest Pastors had their annual golf competition and tournament. And let me tell you, Elgin, you need to know, Britt Gilman looked like Tiger Woods when he was in his prime, all right? In Cathedral, you need to know that Ed Ollie's swing resembled a right-handed Phil Mickelson. In Rolling Meadows, you need to know that Dave Learned should give up golf. I just want to encourage you to do that, all right? I think it's a waste of money for you. I think it save you about 4 hours, well, about 7 hours for you. But we all had a great time. We had a blast. The losing team had less happiness than the winning team had, but hopefully they did still have their joy. But it reminded me of a number of years ago. I was out playing golf. I was out of state somewhere, and so I got matched up with total strangers that day, and the round was going pretty well until about the third hole, and one of the guys who was playing golf got this bright idea. Let me find out what everybody does. He said, what do you do for a living? And the first guy, I'm a teacher. Oh, what do you do? I'm in sales. What do you do? I'm an engineer. And then he pointed at me. What do you do? I'm a pastor. Oh, you talk about the conversation going down quickly. That was a rainstorm coming on the golf course, right? And so everybody, but now the good thing was their language greatly improved, you know, especially for about the next two holes, and then they kind of fell back into their old habits. But one of the guys in the foursome, when he found out I was a preacher, he was consumed with wanting to find out what size of church I preached at. And I kept evading the subject. At the time, I was preaching at a rather large church, and I think people always have stereotypes in their minds of what large churches are like, and so I just was trying to avoid the question. And he asked a couple of times, and I was able to evade it. And then on the 17th hole, he came over to the cart where I was riding with this other guy, and he just looked at me, and he said, how many people were at your church last weekend? And I said, about 20,000 people. And he said, I could just see the wheels turning. And he was just kind of running that number through the filter of his own church experiences. And he stammered and he said, there's no way. He said, there's no way that you can know all 20,000 people. And I said, you're right. I can't, but Jesus can. And the guy beside me leaned over and said, and that's all that matters. And I said, yeah, what he said, right? But he was right. Jesus is all that matters. And more important than how many people come to a church is who you point them to when they do come. And I know that Harvest will always continue to point people to Jesus. Just Jesus. Because he's the only one who matters. And we want his name to become famous, not ours. He is perfect and we are very imperfect. And earlier I said that happiness is based on what's happening in your life. But joy is different. Joy runs deep. Joy comes from within. Joy is more than happiness. It goes beyond the excitement of the pay raise or getting an A on the test or having that first date with that special someone. And back in John 14, in the same conversation, Jesus offered the disciples peace. And now in John 15, he offers them joy. And when we are obedient to the Lord and we are remaining in him, the natural response is joy, overflowing joy. Jesus says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. And when we abide in him, he promises this joy. If you are serious and sincere about remaining in me, he says, then you will obey what I've commanded you. As we talked about back in the Just Jesus series, we learned that God's love language is obedience. In John chapter 15, look at verse 11 one more time. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. There's a purpose behind this. I've challenged you and I'm expecting you to be obedient, to love others as I have loved you. And when you do, the byproduct in your life is overflowing joy. Maybe this will help make it a little easier for us to understand. Back when our kids were very small, they were little, if Beth and I would go out on a date night, we'd leave them with a babysitter for a couple hours. And sometimes before we would go to that restaurant, I would say to the kids, I'd say, hey, I noticed that y'all's rooms are very, very dirty. There's a lot of stuff in there. There's a lot of things. It's a big mess. Before we come home, I want to make certain that you guys clean your rooms. And then we would leave. And we would come back 2 or 3 hours later. And when we would come back, they would be waiting for us at the door. And they were so excited. They said, come in, come in, come in. I said, hey, how'd everything go while we were gone? They would grab my wrist. Come on, follow me to the room. I would go, oh, no, I'm not going in your room. That place is a pig pen. I wouldn't be caught dead in that room. There's no way you're going to, oh, please, please, come with me, Daddy, come with me. And they would drag us in the direction of that room. I said, no, I'll go in, but my eyes are going to be closed. I'm not going to look. Look, Dad, you got to look. Why do I have to look? Just look, Dad, just open your eyes. I said, there were toys all over the place. I'm scared to look. Let me just take a chance on one eye. And I'd open up that eye and I'd look, and the room would be immaculate. Or else they never would have brought me there, right? And I'd say, what in the world happened? Did you guys hire a cleaning crew to come in? No, 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 Dad. We cleaned it ourselves. We did it all by ourselves. You told us to clean the room, and we did it. And this huge smile would creep over my face. And something amazing would happen. My smile became their smile. And it was somehow transferred over to them. How does that happen? Well, when you're obedient, it brings joy. And when they saw our big smiles, they were happy. They just wanted to please their father. And in the process, at a very early age, they discovered that obedience has a double benefit. It brought me joy and it brought them joy. And the same is true when you obey your heavenly father. It leads to overflowing joy. It leads to contentment. Let me add a qualifier to this discussion. When I speak of joy, I'm not talking about a giddiness. I'm not talking about being overly effervescent. There's a difference between happiness and joy, and joy runs deep, and it lasts. It has staying power, even when you go through tough times. And joy brings fulfillment, but it's not always expressed by enthusiasm. At times, it is evidenced through a quiet peace or through a firm faith that we possess. And that's what we hold on to because it gets us through a health challenge or a difficult season or a relational strain or starting over. And when you are attached to the vine and when you are abiding in Christ, this type of joy isn't just possible. It's not probable. It is promised. It is promised to you. Jesus says that your joy may be full. Some translations say that your joy may be overflowing or be complete. It's a word that means to finish. It means to be full of something. And in a world that is so empty and in a world that is so fickle, Jesus is promising a joy that is not fleeting, but one that is full and complete. Even in the midst of the most challenging and unsettling of circumstances, he promises a joy that pours out from being connected to him. Now look at the last two verses in verses 12 and 13. Jesus says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends." And here Jesus defines for the disciples and for us what is the ultimate display of love, and that is being willing to give up your life for someone else. Hey, a life marked by Jesus will always be a life shaped by sacrifice. And Jesus practices what he preaches, and the next day he shows the greatest love by laying down his life for us to become a perfect sacrifice through that loving act. He wiped out our sin debt. And if we will swallow our pride and choose him and abide in him, we can have the benefits of his sacrifice on the cross. But I don't want you to miss this. When he chose the cross and he laid down his own life, it brought him incredible joy. You say, "Well, that sounds kind of masochistic." Well, not if you know what it is that brought him joy. The Hebrew writer says over in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, listen to this. "Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." Well, what was this joy that was before him that allowed him to endure the pain of the cross? What kept him going? What was the finish line? What didn't he have in heaven that he could have down on earth? I mean, in heaven, he had clout, he had authority, he had angels worshiping him, he had everything, he had glory. He was in the presence of God the Father, too. What didn't he have up there that he could have down here? What kept him going? What kept him on the cross? And the one thing he didn't have, was you. It was me. Work, what kept him going? We are why he stayed on the cross when he could have called 10,000 angels to come down. He could have just come down from that cross. But you were the joy, because he knew without him, you couldn't have hope. You couldn't have hope of your sins being forgiven. I couldn't have hope of salvation in Christ. You were his joy. Tim Keller says, if you were his joy, then he can become your joy. And I would add that as you look to him as the author and perfecter of your faith, and as you abide in him, that's what makes all the difference. Yes, it was about a year and a half ago in late March of 2019 when I agreed that when I finished my 30-year ministry in Louisville at the end of May, that in June, the next week in 2019, I would start coming back and forth to Harvest and preach 2 weekends each month. And what was supposed to last 7 months ended up lasting about 16 months. You are tough people to leave. But before I agreed to come, I laid out 3 goals. They were to provide some continuity in the pulpit and to provide some stability for the staff and to provide some encouragement for the church members. And there are so many people that I feel like that I want to thank, but I prefer not to list names. I feel like if I start going through names, I'll talk for 20 minutes just going through names, and I know I'll leave out 10 or 12 more. But let me just say that Harvest has left an indelible impression upon us. I'm thankful for the 18 people who started this church 32 years ago. And I'm thankful that we get to enjoy the shade from a tree that we did not plant. I'm thankful for people who wrote compassionate letters of encouragement to my father, who's in a retirement home trying to cope with the COVID crisis that's all around him, and he's healthy. But over 100 of you have written letters to a total stranger. And it's really lifted his spirits. And I'm thankful to you. I'm thankful for staff who work tirelessly and wear several different hats, and yet they do it for the Lord, not a paycheck. I'm thankful for so many volunteers and lay leaders who are the backbone of this church. I'm thankful for the previous pastor who decades ago instilled within Harvest a love for God's word. And I'm thankful that that emphasis continues to bear fruit in your lives and in this church. And I'm thankful for the way that the vertical worship team just consistently places our focus where it needs to be and allows us to continue to worship the Lord and to put our focus on Him. I'm thankful for versatile members who adjusted to a different style of preaching than what you were used to, and a very different accent, I might add, as well. And thanks so much for all of you welcoming us into the Harvest family. And Beth and I will miss you greatly. Can I tell you what I won't miss? I will not miss the countless Brian Urlacher billboards along Interstate 90, which ruthlessly remind me of my receding hairline. I won't miss that. But let me just say to you, I am thankful for Jesus Christ. I'm thankful that Jesus Christ intersected. Intersected our lives with you. And the gospel of Jesus Christ is much more important than who is standing in a pulpit. And your faithfulness to this book far outweighs any programming decision at a church. And your love and joy are a stronger testimony than the color scheme of your campus lobby or the songs in the worship set or the reach of your social media posts. We've talked about Jesus being our vine today in John 15, but let me just stay in the area of horticulture and move from a vine to move to trees for just a second. I don't know if you've ever been to the National Redwood Forest or the Sequoia National Forest out in California. If so, then no doubt you were amazed at the heights to which those trees can grow. They can grow 200 feet, 300 feet tall. Did you know that a healthy Sequoia Redwood will grow 10 feet in 1 year's time? And you know what their growth is fueled by? The redwood chases after the sun. And where there's sunlight, he chases after that. Redwoods are so hardy, mostly because they are incredibly resistant to things which kill most other trees. A small fire doesn't faze them because the same retardant that you have in your fire extinguisher is on the exterior of a redwood. And their thick bark protects them from beetles and other insects because they can't chew through the hard bark of a redwood. And they're pretty immune to a drought. In fact, it's estimated that beneath the base of the trunk of a healthy redwood are thousands of gallons of water that are held within that root system. And unlike most trees, you would be amazed to discover that the redwoods have a rather shallow root system. Their roots grow outward, and they intertwine with the other redwoods that are nearby. One naturalist said it this way. He said, the giant redwoods of California are literally holding one another up. And to further drive that home, you need to know that redwoods are amazing in how they help out the other trees that are around them. This is tough to explain, but if one tree gets sick and is going through a tough time, the ones nearby can sense it. And they somehow transfer some of their nutrients and their strength through their roots that intertwine with the one that is weak. In effect, they put their life and they put their growth on hold and they focus on the one who is hurting. And after nearly a year and a half of being around here, I just want you to know that the Redwoods analogy is a picture of harvest. As a church, as a membership, you have encountered fiery trials and yet you've allowed them to refine you rather than to consume you. And you have been through the pain of public scrutiny and relentless rumors, the departure of friends, yet you are still standing. You are resilient. You are resistant to those attacks. And someone said that a staff meeting we were at on Thursday said that God sent Beth and God sent us to harvest for you all in your time of need. But hear me when I say, from our perspective, we would say that God sent harvest to us during a pivotal transitional time in our own ministry lives. And God knew that as we moved into a different season of ministry, that we would need the love and the nutrients that you could give to us during that season of our life. You are redwoods to us. You are giants in the faith. Now, may God bless you as you continue to grow in God's word with God's people. And in the good times and the bad times, keep holding one another up. Keep chasing after the sun, Jesus Christ. Because when you abide in him, both your love and your joy will overflow. Harvest, you are loved. Have a good week.